Hey everybody, I'm Leo Mazo, Cochrane Curator of American Art here at the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts, and it's my pleasure to welcome Tommy Emmanuel. Thank you so much for joining us on this episode of Richmond Sessions 22-23. Thanks to my good friends here at In Your Ear Studios as well for making all this happen once again. Richmond Sessions 22-23 features this recording space within the larger exhibition, Storied Strings, a Guitar in American Art. This exhibition, organized by the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts, includes 125 works of art and 35 guitars divided into 17 themes ranging from politics, gender, and blindness to race and ethnicity. Linking these themes is the premise that the guitar as a visual motif has long enabled artists and their human subjects to tell stories that otherwise go untold or undertold. Richmond Sessions 22-23, in turn, is a showcase for contemporary musicians to record songs that demonstrate the power of the guitar as a means for telling stories, invoking universal themes, and weighing in on myriad events. So, Tommy, let me ask you perhaps a rhetorical question here. Is the guitar an expressive and communicating tool, and what does that even mean?
Well, the expressiveness and the communicativeness has to come from us. The guitar is our vehicle. But having said that, the guitar is an orchestra within itself. It's a band within itself, and it's limitless if that's what's going on up here. And that's how it depends on how you visualize what you're doing and how you see it. So that what makes me different from you is I have to be satisfied when I'm playing. All my instincts have to be satisfied. I have to be hearing the melody as if it's a singer. I have to be feeling the groove as if the band are really laying it down for me. And I have to enjoy the space that is created as well as the cluster of things that can go on. So it's the same when I'm writing songs. All my instincts must be satisfied, and they're there for a reason. They're what we're born with. Those things are in our DNA. I remember the day I met the great Jerry Reed, one of my all-time heroes as a player, as a writer, as an artist. Jerry Reed really was high on my list of unique human beings, right? So a friend of mine introduced me to him, and he said, "You got to play a bit of Guitar Boogie for Jerry because he'll love it." And I said, "Okay." So I played it for him. And when I finished, the first thing he said is, "You didn't learn that. You were born with that."
Right.
Right. And he made that statement and made me think, maybe he's right. Maybe there's part of our humanness that is born into us, and which would explain why certain parts of us have to be satisfied for us to feel like we're doing the job. If you listen to Billy Joel talking about songwriting, I hear the same thing. He's visualizing, things, and then he's making them come to life because his instincts need to be satisfied, right? So when I'm writing a song, the picture has to be right, the story has to unfold, and I have to find a way of being able to do that without any words. And this is the art part of our musical nature here. That's the art part of it. It's one of the hardest parts to explain to somebody. I was playing a song I'd just written the other day for a young guitar player, and she said, "How did you come up with that part?" I said, "Because this part was asking a question and it had to be answered by this. And then I put this little part in here, which is saying to me, are you listening?" You know what I mean? But so how do I explain that to you, that's what it's saying to me?
Right. You know, I think about that line in John Denver's song, "This Old Guitar," where he says, "This old guitar taught me to sing a love song."
And
this whole idea, do your guitars teach you?
Oh, absolutely. They're always the same, but I'm always different, you know, down to minute details. People don't realize just how different we are on a moment-to-moment basis or a day-to-day basis. But some guitars bring out certain qualities. Like when I pick up an old guitar, I immediately start singing Jimmy Rogers songs or Hank Williams songs and go back to my childhood, you know. And an old guitar will do that to you. And then, you know, if I pick up this guitar, this is an Australian-made guitar, and this is my particular model. So when I pick it up, it's like I'm immediately in touch with my voice. My voice is here, you know. And the moment I hear it, sometimes it only just takes playing a few chords. It only takes playing a few little things like that. It's starting to turn on my creativity. You know what I mean? It's like it's just turning the switch. Other times, it just pours out of you and you can't stop it, you know? And you're always waiting for something like that. A songwriter, a storyteller like me, is waiting for something to happen all the time.
Waiting for something to happen. It never stops.
Yeah. Even like I'm in England somewhere and I get on a train and the train makes a sound that I haven't heard before and it's a certain rhythm and all of a sudden I've got an idea and there are like four ideas going at once. I'm hearing this, what would I do with that? And I'm listening because the train is making a certain sound. So the train causes me to do that. I remember when Rodney Crowell was on tour with me, and Rodney and I had recorded a song on my album, Accomplice One. And I've always been a Rodney Crowell fan. He's a great American songwriter. He's a typical Texas style of writing, playing, singing, but he's completely unique, as was so many others from that area. But if he got an idea, it was like you couldn't move him from it. He would stick with that idea. There's artistic people are interesting to be around.
Yes.
Because there is that innate thing must be satisfied.
Right.
You know.
Right. So you've mentioned a few times now a song you very recently
yeah.
have written. Could you tell us a little bit about it and perhaps play it?
All right. I can do that. Okay, so. And I knew the title of the song was important to this piece. So my granddaughter is Scarlett, right? And I'm a big Scarlett Johansson fan. And that movie, Lucy, really inspired me and made me think about the world and humanity and where things are going and all that sort of stuff. And it just occurred to me, I was flying over to Europe and I was checking out the news and I was seeing what was going on in all around our world. And I started thinking, what kind of world is Scarlett going to be living in when she's 20 years old, you know? And so the song is called Scarlett's World. This was written in the style of if I went back to the 80s and was a band like A-ha. You know, I wanted it to have a like 80s sound to it, right? And it also, it has long passages where there's not a lot of notes, you know, it's simple. So I tried to write a pop song from the 80s with that kind of theme, okay? So here's a little bit of Scarlett's World.
Yeah.
Wow.
Scarlet's World.
Tommy.
Yeah.
Can I ask how old Scarlet is now?
4.
Has she heard this?
Yep.
What does she think of it?
It's granddad playing the guitar.
You know? Love that.
Yeah.
I love that.
Thank you.
You know, I didn't know exactly where you were going to go, but I've never heard the B minor AG sound quite like that.
Yeah, because it's da, la, la,
with a little major seven. Yeah, that's so good.
And well, you know, it also creates, if I can just, if I can tell you what it makes me feel,
please.
It creates a sense of urgency. It's urgent that things get better. You know what I mean? So, you know, but things are whizzing by us. Time is whizzing by us. And the world is turning and the planes are flying and the trains are going and we're changing and we're growing and things are good, things are bad, all that. But it's whizzing by us. And there's a sense of urgency to don't forget, you know, that love is our most important thing. Family and love is everything. All the other stuff is just scenery. So the song has all that humanity in it, but yet it's almost like a movie in itself. And that's kind of how I like to write. You know what I mean?
Beautiful. So that...
It's a singable thing, right? This is... It's almost like a little... You know, we're just warning you in a friendly way that things better get better. Here in Scarlet's World. Right? Yeah. And I get to the bridge fairly quickly... Right? Instead of doing like a double verse, as a pop songwriter, you would say, well, you've got to do verse one, verse two, and then you get to the chorus. You know, but in this song, it's already laid the foundation. So now I need it to take me to another thing. So it's almost like two people having a serious conversation. Yeah, you said... Well, I agree with you.
Tommy, that's exactly what this exhibition is about.
Wow.
I've never been able to say it as poetically as you just did. It is a conversation.
That's exactly right. And there are parts in the song where it's all, or what comes to my mind, if I'm demonstrating the song to someone, it's almost, this part is saying, are you listening? You know, are you getting it? You know what I mean? And to me, it's obvious, but that's only obvious to me unless I meet someone who's on the same kind of thought pattern and go, oh, that's about blah, 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 you know. It's like when I was trying to write Lewis and Clark, you know, it's an example of how important inspiration is for us to be artistic and for us to do something that's way beyond us. You know, that's way beyond our realm. So a song that truly touches people and truly tells a story, it just comes through you. It's not you, it's coming through you. And you have to know that. And you need to get yourself out of the way and let it flow through you. That's what I think. With the song Lewis and Clark, I read the journals of Lewis and Clark and I was so inspired by their story and I suddenly realized I've got to write it. I've got to tell it. How do I do that with no words? How do I talk about the great unknown, the American West, the native people, the rivers, the valleys, the prairies? How do I do that? I don't know, but here it comes. You know what I mean? I was so inspired. So when I wrote the song, I started looking for changes that would make, and I always reference the John Lennon's Imagine as a song that is full of constant moving, constant motion, right? The chord structure has constant motion, right? It's going somewhere, right? Because it's going... So it's constantly moving, right? Now I've got to find chords that sound like we're going somewhere, but we don't quite know what's going to happen because it's the great unknown, right? If you know, so I found... So there's an element of native there. Now tell me this story. So there's the verse. It's starting to open up and tell us the story. And so I got to the point at the end of the verse where the most important thing is the chorus of this song. It's got to just go boom and hit you right here, right? So what happened to me was I was so inspired and so excited. This part happened in 5 minutes. I had all that written and all laid out, and I knew without question that it was right, right? I didn't want to go in and change anything. But then the chorus had to be right. So each time I got to that section, there are two songwriters going on. There's one up here, and he's very clever. He's full of a million ideas, and he's throwing them at me, right? But there's one down here, and he must be satisfied. And it's all about, it has to be so authentic. It has to be so right, you know, and it has to deliver, you know. And so this guy's throwing all the ideas. This one keeps saying, nope, that's not right. That's not it. And I know I'm trying to be too clever. I'm trying to be too clever. Put it away. Do something else, you know. So I went on and on and on. And I could not write the most important part of the song to me. The chorus. So I eventually had to surrender. So I put my guitar down and I went to bed. And I said to myself, it's got to come to me. It will happen. And so I just left it. I knew that what I had to that point was right. I wouldn't want to change it. So the next morning I got up and I walked out on the balcony of this little hotel where I was staying and looked across the lake. And I suddenly imagined that I was like in a canoe and I'm riding along in the water. And a voice in my head said, if you bring your love with you, we'll welcome you. If you bring your love with you. And with that phrase came a melody. If you bring your love with you. Right? Like that. So... Now, there's the chorus I was looking for. It appeared just like I thought it would. I just had to wait, you know, because there are some things you have to trust in your gift and your instinct. You have these instincts for a good reason, you know. And so if I play the verse leading into the chorus. So I had the verse and the chorus. So I wrote it, two verses, chorus, verse, chorus, chorus, out. There was no need for a bridge or to tell more about the story. The whole story unfolded in that much music, right? So I had to fight off my instincts as a performer to put more stuff in there, to try to dress it up a bit more. I had to fight off those desires because they're very strong. I'm an entertainer. I'm in the entertainment business. I have to deal with the art that is given me, and I have to be true to it. If I'm not, it will not work. So I got rid of all my ideas that were being thrown at me, all my instincts for wanting to dress it up. And I just said, I'm going to have to find the courage to play this on stage and not do anything else. Not do anything, just tell the story. And I found it, you know.
There's a famous story of, it's almost cliched by this point, but what you're talking about, paring away the cleverness and all that, reminds me of that classic Michelangelo story that he had to chip away at all the stuff around the sculpture to get to it, for the actual sculpture to
That's exactly appear. Right. Yeah. Interesting, isn't it?
It is. Can I just to change the conversation a little bit, and maybe I'm off base here, but it occurs to me that while we tap to keep time, that your movement of your left foot is about more than keeping time. It's almost an extension of what you feel coming through you. Is that going too far?
You're the first person who said that, but you're absolutely right. Yeah. Sometimes I have to feel every beat. Sometimes I have to just feel a longer passage. You know what I mean? So if I'm playing the song, dun, 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 like that, dun, 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 I'm the drummer. It's the drummer. Dun, dun,
dun, dun. But your whole body's moving too.
Yeah. That's because the song, I am the song, right? The song is in me, and I'm putting it to you through this instrument. But I am the song somehow. And I can't even explain that.
Would you be willing to play Lewis and Clark all
the way through? Oh, sure. Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Wow. That's pretty great. That's
it's probably one of the simplest things I've ever written. But it was so hard to write that, you know.
Right. At the end of the introduction to Lewis and Clark, there's a slight play with harmonics.
Yeah, it's...
And in Scarlet, there were some harmonics. And then in Secret Love, there's something just wild going on with harmonics.
Well, Secret Love is a song from my childhood. And I use a technique in that that I learned from Chet Atkins and Lenny Bro.
Yes.
And it's commonly called cascading harmonics or artificial harmonics. And artificial harmonics is an artificial statement. It's real harmonics. They're just not all harmonics. They're a combination of natural notes and harmonics together. But if you do it well, your ear can't tell which one is which if you do it right. So with Secret Love, I mean, I was already playing tunes like the Beatles' Michelle, where I was playing. So I was using a combination of open harmonics, cluster harmonics, all that sort of stuff to spell out the melody and to embellish it, right? So I was already doing all that stuff. But with Secret Love, this is an arrangement of mine that took me a while to come up with, and then I had to find the courage to play it on stage and be willing to put it all out there, because with a song like this, and there's nothing else, it's just the guitar with a bit of reverb and all that, you're completely naked, you know what I mean? So in order to get... Right, so if you miss one of those, you're missing a melody note. You know what I mean? And so you're not going to wear egg. You're going to wear the entire chicken on your face. So you better get it right. Yes. You know what I mean? So I practiced it for a long time before I found the courage to play it on stage. Once I'd done it, once I was cool. I knew I could do it. I just had to make myself do it. After that part's all gone through, now we're into the bridge. So what I started to think, okay, this can't be like anything I've done before, and I've got to think outside of myself, of my box, you know what I mean? So I started thinking, okay, I'm going to be Lenny. The bridge is going to be Lenny. What would Lenny do? So I was trying to be a method actor, as a musician. So Lenny would be looking for piano chords that were unresolved and then resolve, unresolved and then resolve, and surprising at every turn. So how do I do that? So the melody, now I shouted from the tires, right? That's the beat. So... resolve. Mm-hmm. So then it goes into there, right? And then it does a key change, and it has a beautiful and powerful ending. And I came up with that arrangement because I was trying to think outside of myself. How can I surprise even myself with this? So that's what I did. At every turn, there was an unresolved chord, then a resolved. And do you know what? That's really entertaining.
Yeah.
I read a great interview with Penn and Teller, two of the most successful entertainers in the last 50 years, right? And this journalist said, "What is entertainment?" And Penn said, "Surprise me." And he said, "No, what is entertainment?" He said, "Yeah, surprise me. That's entertainment." And I thought about that, and I thought, how can I surprise the listener at every turn, come up with an unusual thing, you know? But not leave the general public behind. It's not too clever that only a jazz purist would get it, you know what I mean? It has heart and it has surprise, but the melody is still telling me what I need to hear.
There's something very demystifying about your playing. You know, there's something as much technique and finesse as obviously goes into this. There's something about removing the pretension.
Yeah.
And removing the ooh and ah mystery about this, that it's almost you're almost giving a clinic in the fact that I feel joy, you can feel joy too.
Well, it's pretty basic, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. When I'm having a great time on stage, I'm doing my drum solo, or bang my head on the microphone, or playing the guitar with a brush. I'm doing all sorts of stuff. It's completely, ridiculous, but people are loving it, and it's musical and it's fun. And I finish the piece, and I say, "Wouldn't you like to have this much fun?"
Yeah. So, getting back to, you mentioned Lenny Bro and Chet Atkins. Mm-hmm. So you wrote the song Chet's Ramble with Chet Atkins.
Well, Chet's Ramble was a song that Chet sent me a tape back in the 90s of some tunes that he hadn't finished because he'd called me about us recording together, right? So I already had quite a few songs that I suggested to the project, and they ended up on there, right? Chet had quite a few songs that he suggested as well that made it onto the record. But there was about four songs, I think, on that tape that we never got to. And so a year after his passing, which was June 29th of 2001 was when he passed. So it was June 29th of 2002. I was living in England, and I got up early in the morning and I came downstairs to make my coffee, and I put on a Chet record. And I just started thinking, what can I do to celebrate his life, to celebrate him the man and him the person and him the player, the writer, the producer, you know, the great person that he was. What can I do to celebrate him today? And I suddenly realized I hadn't listened to that tape in a long time. I went to the tape and I found this song, which Chet, he's saying, "Well, it's not finished, and it's just like a little old fiddle tune. You know, it's like an Appalachian fiddle tune. And it, you know, it really needs a bridge, and it needs a few things. And if you can get to it, great, you know." And that's what was on the tape. And I thought, he's telling me today, a year after he's gone, that I better guess. So what he sent me sounded like this. So it sounds like a fiddle tune, like a children's mountain fiddle tune, right?
Right.
So I found a way of going.
Mm-hmm.
that far with it. I said, okay, I can repeat that. It's like old Joe Clark or any of those kind of tunes, right? But now my instincts are the melody has to stay the same, but the chords should be different underneath. Otherwise, it's just going to be boring, you know? So... So now we're into the second verse, and it's a little different, and it's nice. But then we get to that point. Now we need a release, you know. So this is what I wrote. Leading us back into the bridge, right? So if you hear that in tempo and in context, it's a nice lift, right? Here's the bridge. So now it leads us back into there. So now we need that again. And then the second time, as the writer, I knew I had to do something completely left field now. It needs to surprise the listener. So at the end of the second bridge, we do a key change. Now we're in C. Right. But I thought, I need to surprise you and take you where you don't think, or you have no idea where it's going to go, right? And so what I did is, I did this key change, but it led back into the original key, which is kind of a strange thing to do, but it really works well. Check it out. You come back in on the second half in the other original key, right?
Well, so, you can do that.
Yeah. Yeah. So this lick, you think it's going to go into C, and it's led us back there. Down there. Original melody and the different chords and take it home. And there, you hear that chord? That's we're going home. That chord, that's what it says to me. If you want to have a we're going home chord, that's the one. Check it out. That heralds to me, oh, okay, we're getting ready to go home. It's coming to an end. So once I had all that written, I then said, how am I going to start this tune and end it and make it interesting? So I start going, oh, well, it's a fiddle tune. It's bluegrass. And I said, oh, what goes with a fiddle? A mandolin. Okay, so I look for the sound of a mandolin. Here it is. That's what a mandolin sounds like if you play it open, right? So, oh, that sounds nice. There's the intro, right? It's from the mandolin sound. Now the ending. So it's a definite ending. And now we've covered everything.
So let me ask you a question, though. And I don't even know how to ask this. But when you're going da-na-da-na in the key of A,
yeah,
you have this choice. about mixing things up. How do you know to go to descend, to G and F sharp? I mean, it makes sense, but where does that come from? At what point in the writing do you say, all right, and enough of da-da-da-da-da, I'm going to descend a little bit?
Well, it could be a combination of listening to enough Beatles tunes, which is full of that stuff.
Yes.
And stealing as much as you can from it.
Right.
It could also have been an idea, could have come from a Hank Williams song, or an Eagles song, or whatever, you know. It's all laid out there for us, you know. Before you and I were born, everything was already laid out. We just got lucky because we're old enough to have witnessed the first time we heard a Beatles song to what we're listening to the Beatles now and what we're hearing in their music that we didn't hear when we were kids. And we realized that all that stuff, all the really good stuff of great songs, great production, great playing and all that, it slowly seeps into us. It's got into us. And that's what it's supposed to do. So the reason I know, that is because I've heard that sound before.
Right. Yeah. But you Tommyize these. You do, you know, you have your own thing. Would you be willing to do one of your medleys of
The
Beatles?
Yeah. Well, let's talk about technically how that comes together. You're going to see through my mind how this works. So players who are not technically up to it yet, when they see me play Lady Madonna or Day Tripper and they hear both the parts clear as a bell and they go, I want to do that. I want to play Lady Madonna, blah, blah, blah. Okay, all right. You have to know that you're going to have to get in the trench. You're going to have to go one bar at a time and you're going to have to ease your way into it and work because it's a lot harder than you think to play it well, right? So when you're learning something like Lady Madonna, you have to really know what your mission is. And I knew that when I wanted to work that out, my mission was to play the piano part. Right? And the singing part. Lady Madonna, children at your feet, wonder how to I want to do both those parts at the same time, and I want it to groove and to have a life of its own kind of thing. How do I do that? Well, I'll tell you. You can't do the two parts separately. You have to learn the whole thing one measure at a time. So here it is, slowed right down for you. That's the first two measures, right? It doesn't sound like music yet. It's just a bunch of notes put together. Second part. Let's join those two pieces together. Now the second part. Right? So that's all the parts to the verse, right? So now you practice that until and you practice that over and over and over and over. Musicians have to have repetition. It's our friend. It's the same as a metronome. We hate metronomes, but they're our best friend. So you practice that, then you work out the second part. Right? So you know how it goes. So when you get all the parts right, even at a snail's pace, and you know it's right, now you switch from learning to practice, right? Now you start practicing. You don't play anything else but this until you can play this in time, with feeling and all that. And so what it is, the message here is, when you're learning a new piece like this, it's not music yet. It's skill. You're learning new skills. When you practice those skills enough, it's like magic. The music suddenly appears. It shows up. It's there. Because now what happens, it's a shift here. You shift from trying to get all the messages together of this new skill you've learned, and now your hands know what to do, and your brain goes, oh, great, now I can concentrate on one thing, the melody. Right. And so when I play Lady Madonna for you today, because I've been playing it like this since about 1977, right? So it's a long time. But I'm only just starting to play it well. You know what I mean? I'm starting to really get on top of it now. It's taken all my life, right? So when I play it for you today, I'm not thinking about any skill whatsoever. I'm only thinking about how do I want to make it feel? Do I want to go, Lady Madonna, children at your feet? Or do I want to go, Lady Madonna, children at your feet? Do I want to make the melody, and do I want to anticipate the melody like McCartney could do, you know? So don't know how you manage to make it. Now I start to put the band in, right? So I start banging on the guitar with the downbeat. So now I'm enjoying playing it. I'm adding all these little kind of Ray Charles-y piano. I'm adding those kind of things in there to make it interesting and fun. So it takes a lot of practice to get all that stuff to, because what practice does is set you free. It allows you to be completely creative on another level the moment you stop thinking about, I'm chained down to all this skill, you know. You know, now once I've played it enough and practiced it enough and really worked it, I'm set free. The chains come off and I don't think about the skill. I only think about the melody and the feeling of it and what do I want to do, you know, because my hands know what to do. So shall I play a Day Tripper and Lady Madonna for you?
That would be great.
Keep going. Here we go.
Well, she's a big deal. She took me half the way there. Better.
So. Wow. I like it too when you speed up a little bit at the end.
Oh, well, there you go. That's in the name of entertainment. Right. And also to take it to a place of, holy hell, what else is he going to do? It's right. The same as with classical gas, where I kept changing the ending and adding stuff because I wanted to give the audience that feeling of, he can't possibly do any more to this. And then, oh yeah, watch this, you know? And it's so, it just goes on and on and on. But it's all musical and it makes sense. But it's also, I'm having fun with your mind and your feelings, you know? I'm saying, do you think you've had enough fun yet? No, you haven't. Check this out. You know what I mean?
That gets to the whole Penn and Teller thing you talked about surprise.
People forget we're in the entertainment business. It's like I remember one time I had some really great guys managing me, and I did this show. I was just in a fabulous mood and I was playing well, and I was like all over the shop. I was running around the stage and I was joking with the audience and having the best time. And I came off stage high as a kite from being Mr. Entertainment, you know. I walked into my dressing room and there's my two managers sitting there with this kind of dark look on their face. And I said, what's up? And they said, you can't do that. Do you see Eric Clapton running around the stage telling jokes? No. You know, if you want people to take you seriously, you've got to stop doing all that stuff. And it hurt me. It stopped me right in my tracks. And I went away and thought about it. And I said, okay, I can understand that. But I know Eric. And he's actually a pretty funny guy when he wants to be. But he's not a joker on stage like I am. And if I can't be myself on stage, then I'm not going on stage. You know? It's an important thing for an artist to really be, you know, like, take everything off and say, this is who I am. I'm vulnerable, I'm open, and this is who I am. It's also part of the package of accepting that this is who I am, this is how I play. I can't be Segovia. I can't be George Benson. I can't be Steve Vai. I can't, you know, I can try to play like all that, but I have to be happy being me. And seeing things the way I do and do my best to expand my knowledge and be an open vessel. But I have to find a piece in that, you know. So that's why I love what I'm doing. And I know that the formula for success, I don't know the formula for success, but I know how to fail. And how you fail is trying to please everybody, because that's impossible. So I know and accept that not everyone's going to like what I do, you know, and that's just human nature, you know. And there are people out there who their whole thing is to criticize, and I could care less about critics. When a journalist says, what do you say to your critics who say you're too entertaining and blah, 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 I say, they don't exist, you know. They don't exist in my world. You know, I just do what I do. Enough people love it, and enough people have a great time, and I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. I'm serving to them something that they can't get from someone else. They're going to get something else from Billy Joel or from Elton John or from, you know, or whatever. It doesn't matter. So I have to find peace with my art and who I am. That's what works for me, you know.
Yeah, this is such a refreshingly healthy attitude. Anyone watching this is going to get more than a clinic. And it seems that by being honest to yourself, one thing I know for me is that I, on the Rick Beato interview,
all right,
you played, I mean, I certainly respect the Bee Gees, but I had never heard your version, your take.
Oh, of
Tommy's take of How Deep Is Your Love.
You know, I got to play on Barry Gibb's remake of How Deep Is Your Love because he heard me playing that. And Barry's a very dear friend of mine. And he's, you know, I'm a Gibb too. Every time I'm with him, I say, I'm your other brother. And when my brother Phil passed away, the first phone call to me was Barry Gibb because he knew exactly how I felt.
That's wonderful. Would you Would you be so kind as to...
I don't play all the backing.
Yeah?
I just play the singer's part. Shall right. I just do that?
Please, really? Yes.
Okay. All right. Here we go.
What a beautiful rendition of a beautiful song.
Oh, it's gorgeous. Oh. It doesn't need any improvising, take a solo, none of that. Just play the song. Just be the singer, you know?
It makes me realize how many of their songs are more than a matter of hooks, but they're intricate, yet simple, just joyful melodies.
Yeah.
The other thing that occurred to me was by only doing the melody of the singer, I was able to hear sustain, like...
There you go.
Yeah, and it was great. It also occurred to me that your tapping foot in that was really effective, has a sustain all its own.
Mm. Well, also there are passages. You see, I try to play like a singer would. A singer doesn't always sing right on the beat. Sometimes a singer will come in late, especially like Sinatra or Willie Nelson will be here next week. You know, he's that far behind the beat, you know. But they have a certain sound and they have a way of doing things. Really good singers don't oversing stuff. They don't put too much in there. If they're going to do an embellishment, it will be a really cool little thing and then that's it. Like, let me give you a good example. And I use this song not only as a demonstration thing when I'm teaching, but sometimes I play it live and people really love it. I use singers' skills and ideas in my melody playing. Right, so we're going to take Nat King Cole's Mona Lisa, right? So First thing I tell people, if you're going to learn a song like Mona Lisa, go and listen to Nat King Cole sing it 20 times. Listen to it over and over. Listen how he interprets the melody. What does he do? Where are his embellishments? How does he phrase it? All that stuff, right? So.
Wonderful.
So let me point out
the
vocal things now, shall I?
Please.
A singer doesn't just sing like that. So he goes, Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa, men have named you, you know. So the other thing I wanted to point out was Chet Atkins told me a long, long time ago, when you're learning a song, learn the words. So the words are in your head when you're playing the melody. So. Even just that phrase. you hear how the harmony and the melody are not da 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 da, because people don't sing all like that. It's li li li. It's two voices moving along. The harmony is not exactly in time with the melody, which gives it a beautiful feel. Now, check this out. That's a vocal idea where the melody is played on the beat and the harmony is a whisker late behind it. And that's kind of how singers sing. They don't sing boom like that. It's like, you hear that? There's the harmony. There's the melody. So instead of playing like Jose in the Mexican restaurant down the road, I play. Right, so the melody is on the beat and the harmony is a fraction behind it. That creates feeling in melody playing. Now, I want to play the melody, but I want it to be beautiful. How can I make it sound really beautiful? Well, I need sustain. So, there it is. It goes, right? That's the melody. So, and everything rings. These are little details that, you know, it's already taken me a while just to get to this part of the song. There's so much more to go, you know what I mean? Now, I do a little contra motion thing here. The harmony goes down and the melody goes up. What's that? It's a little trill. It's a, you know, that all good singers can do. Instead of, then I go, and boom, dee, 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 that's the melody. So I'm going, and letting that sustain. A little diminished run there. There's the melody. A little lick I stole from Chet back in my high school days. So, Mona Lisa, or just a cold and lonely. And they're all vocal ideas, right? And there's one little change. Let me kind of top and tail this by saying, if you listen to Nat King Cole sing the song, he goes, they just lie there. The first time he goes, they just lie there and they die there. That's the melody, right? But the second time he goes, they just lie there and they die. So I go, right, I quote him there. Yeah. But you wouldn't have known that unless I pointed it out. You see what I mean? But that's the kind of detail that if you want to be an expressive player, you got to look for details like that, you know? And they're so beautiful. It's such a beautiful feeling to play this song for you guys here listening, because it's such an extraordinarily beautiful melody. And to interpret it in a way like a singer is one of the most fulfilling experiences as a player, you know, because I feel like I'm so in touch with the song that the song's fulfilling all my needs at the same time.
It certainly comes across.
Thank you.
And Tommy, it's really been a pleasure chatting with
same
you.
Same here. Thank
and,
you, Leo.
I was wondering if you would take us out to go to a very different tune. You know, you talked to the Lewis and Clark about motion and moving. Something similar might be applied if someone were to write an interpretation. Yes! You read my mind.
I'm trying to read your mind.
It is your song. You know, I remember when I first listened to this, thinking that the higher notes, as much as any of your tunes, the higher notes on this are really like words being sung. Is that an intentional thing? Or?
Yeah. Fuel is a train song. It's a song written on a train trip, and it's got motion, and it's got everything. Really, what I did when I wrote Fuel is I said, I've got to replace classical gas. You know what I mean? I've got to think that I'm replacing that song with something that's even more full of good stuff. You know, so that was my thought. How can I outdo classical gas? You can't really, but that was my thought process.
Gotcha.
And I had that sound for years in my arsenal, in my cupboard up here. I had that sound, and then I thought, there's how I can use it, right? So, and then the rest of it all came together pretty quickly. It took me about an hour solid to write the whole song, and then I practiced it up. I played it that night at the show. Wow. You know, so it was a whole different ball game. It's not like Secret Love. I practiced it for a year before I went on stage with it. You know what I mean? Because it had to be ridiculously perfect. So. Whoa.
Tommy Emmanuel, thank you so much for being part of Richmond Sessions 22-23. This has really been just a wonderful program for us.
Thank you.
And thank you so very much, and thank you all for tuning in.
Thank you.